With me on stage is a wonderful person who will talk to us about CPU development, power, open source, and how this all fits together and how this will hopefully influence our future CPU architecture and development. So please give a very warm round of applause to Matteo Michel.
Okay. Thanks for having me here today. And I apologize in the beginning for my strong German-Saxon mixture of German and English. So sorry for that, because I'm coming from Saxony, actually, living in Chemnitz still, born in Chemnitz, grew up in Chemnitz, or Karl-Marx-Stadt, whoever knows about that. That's why the accent is still a mixture of Saxon and German, but still want to show that there are still smart people living in Saxony, not just people in Dresden waving some strange flags all the time. I want today... thanks. I just want to give a brief introduction today about open power. I got inspired, I think 2 years ago, by a talk by David Kaplan, who was talking about CPU development altogether from scratch to the final product and all the steps through it. So I also want to touch that briefly today, but I want to go more into open power and just tell you something about it, because I'm not really sure if everybody knows about that foundation, and might also be a little off topic in this conference here, but maybe still of interest. This is my agenda for the day. So first of all, like to just talk a little bit about me, then as mentioned, about the CPU development flow at all and why open power. About myself, as I mentioned, still living in Chemnitz, but I'm my desk is located here. This is the Böblingen lab of IBM Germany. I'm there in the verification department of CPU development. It's not just located there. It's a worldwide distributed team, virtual teams. So I'm working together with people in Bangalore, US, France, England, and so on. So basically, all the continents are included. My main focus is verification. I'm also not an expert of open power, but I'm just still involved in some topics of it. That's why I think I can at least talk about some steps here. And that's all about me. Let's go into the technical agenda. This is the CPU development flow as we are still working it today at IBM. So we basically, it's a simple overview. You start at the left by either coding or generating or somehow specifying some hardware description, maybe VHDL, maybe Verilog, whatever you think might work. This is also large arrow pointing to it, the source that I'm using usually for verification. There are also multiple different versions of HDL that are possible, but just assume it's basically one thing that is basically specifying the hardware, how it should work, and there is some kind of tool stream that basically converts all the different things to the final product on the right. So out of the HDL, you get a netlist with all those logic components being generated. There are also some other specific verification teams working on that one. Then you can generate the schematics out of it. You will see some transistors in there. Basically forming those transistors into the layout. And with the layout, you basically get to the final product, the IC at the end, out of the fabrication process. I will also have some numbers later today, but assume this process you can go through on a daily basis, but from a first line of VHDL code until the final product, just assume like 2 or 3 years until you have a real working product. Now there's some nasty flowchart from some of my colleagues that somehow just should illustrate how the overall flow is somehow working. So you just saw the version coming from hardware description language into the product. Now this is the workflow inside the company itself. So you have basically some kind of product. You basically what is your target or basically the previous version. You have some customer that somehow has some urgent need for certain things to run. That and he basically gives some kind of specification. You have some teams working on high-level design, and then this is basically your input source. Sometimes very specific, sometimes very loose, and then you have different teams working in parallel, trying to get this product put together. So we have some kind of system component teams that are looking at the boards and all the electrical components on it. You have a team that's looking at this black box, where to put it at the end. You have firmware teams, you have basically design teams that writing that VHDL code or Verilog code, and then you have basically at the end a verification team that is basically making sure that this also works at the end before you go to the fab and get it produced. And then you have also other teams looking at timing, looking at circuit design, integration. So that's all going more into physics, which is really important at the processor design because you want to have the maximum performance coming out of your product. When you're done, basically, you push the button, get it fabricated. Then there are some tests going on. And if that goes well, then you have a good machine. Sometimes you find bugs. That's why this small red dollar sign is coming in. If you find bugs, you basically want to find them as early as possible to basically turn around your logic until it really works before you get to the fab. If you miss that point, you have to spend much more dollars on it, and then you have to spend multiple cycles on that. Just be sure you don't want to be that person being responsible for having to re-spin through the fab, because that process going to the fab is like 2 months, 2.5 months, and you don't want to be that person, first of all, spending the money and also causing that delay for the customers at the end. And if you are a really bad person, then at the end, you get into manufacturing. All those machines are being put to the customer side. They push a button and nothing works. And let's don't talk about that. But I didn't see that in my life so far. This is another picture, somehow trying to illustrate the same thing again, but now trying to decide to the left, more to design verification, on the right side, more to physical stuff that is being done. So you see physical design, synthesis, placement, routing, stuff that you know needs to be done, but basically I personally don't want to be in that area. It's always critical, and you will always be at the end of the process. Everybody's waiting for you to push the button. That's why I chose the left side, being more on the verification front, also dealing very close with the design teams. And you see, it's two circles circling because you are always working somehow on the same source, different times, and that's basically what you do all the time. Going more into a kind of continuous integration. Okay, and here are the numbers that I promised. Somehow try to compare the numbers from building a larger ship compared to a processor. And that's quite interesting because somehow at the end, when comparing, you for both things you need at the end for the whole system about 3,000 people. Also about the construction time, it's similar. So like 3 years for the chip, like 4 to 5 years for the whole processor and system. It's not 4 to 5 years for just one shot. It's basically multiple turns of the processor until the machine is basically ready to ship to the customer. And also, you see the costs at the end, so it's more than $1 billion that needs to be spent for one generation of those systems. Just to mention, there are two architectures currently still being worked on at IBM. It's the Power architecture and the C architecture. Those numbers are for the C processor, but you basically can compare those pretty similar from a cost point of view. So. That's already it from the CPU development side. So let's jump into OpenPower. Looking at that, that's why I called white OpenPower, because sometimes it looks strange. why should something change in that kind of hardware stuff? It's always be there. So you see, you work on your PCs, you see somehow getting smaller, you have your phones, but somehow similar kind of stuff in there. Also from the server part of it, it's somehow in some building in the cellar, and it should just work. But there is some commercial component to it. Over years, this kind of process worked very well for players like IBM or others. But basically, over time, the market shifted drastically. So you have Moore's Law, which basically provided over years a very constant flow of performance improvements. So you didn't have to do much. You just had to move to the next generation of your technology. And then surprisingly, you got 10, 20, whatever percent out of new performance without changing much in your design. Nevertheless, you added more features to it to satisfy customer needs. But that is more and more never true anymore. Also, on the other side, you have other trends like new kind of workloads are coming up. Just think about some kind of Bitcoin mining, which is somehow trending today or these days. But also kind of consumption models of those server farms are changing. And in previous years, it was like somebody from some company called, I need new machines. Then the customer representative moved there and sold something which was staying there for the next couple of years. But these days, cloud is something very drastically changing the operation model of our sellers at IBM. And that also basically was something that we felt, because at the end, just less and less products were sold. The cloud infrastructure was not up and running from our point of view, because we didn't bet on that. Other companies like Amazon were very fast on bringing it up. So as you can see today, most of the cloud infrastructure is x86 based, and I think it's hard to find power servers for the open public cloud providers. On the other side, you have seen also the software ecosystem changed a little, so the, to more open and mature open providers. That's one part of it. And on the other side, you have some kind of strategy changes that you need to do now, but more to that later on. Just back to the Moore's Law. On that chart, you see, it's basically compared performance per dollar. That's something the customers look at. So they look at how much money they need to spend for which kind of performance, and that's the number they compare between the different providers. And then only if you can match or be below the other companies, then you are able to sell stuff to them. And as I mentioned before, that was working quite well for the past couple of years, but now basically Moore's Law is slowing down and doesn't help anymore. So what you are now trying to do is you need to somehow enhance the performance by other means. So what could that be? So you could plug something to your system. So you can't move everything onto the processor because you just can't fabricate it. So you need to do something close to the processor. You can plug some accelerators on it. You can somehow work on the storage systems to be faster. You can look at the I/O if you can move to a new generation there. Or you can look at the memories if they can provide you something. But at the end, everything comes together at a data point. So data is that thing that somehow is told to be the issue over the next couple of years because of different trends. You have Internet of Things providing much or sometimes too much data, and you just somehow need to handle it. So every device is somehow creating data. At the end, you need to have some backbone working on it, and basically some compute centers that can deal with all those data. And you see what kind of data the creators of those charts basically envisioned coming from different fields. Coming more to open power, and basically, Moore's Law is something I've already talked about, but there were basically two other things that forced this kind of creation of this open power community. The second thing was Google. Google was basically known to be a large provider of something like search or other stuff. And somehow they were not really happy with their x86 infrastructure. So somehow there were talks between other companies and also with IBM, and they basically ran some stuff on back then Power8 machines and were surprised for different patterns that were surprisingly good. And on the other side, they also basically were looking right in the eye of a monopoly of Intel. So that was a second thing Google was not being afraid, was afraid of, and basically seeing that this was creating a very costly infrastructure. So basically being bound to a monopolist and then not open to any movement somewhere else. And that's why they basically failed to do something else. And also at the end, don't really know, but at the end, they want to build their own computers. And that's why they searched for some partnering and at the end came to IBM and looked at us if we can do something together. As well as the third point is extend the reach of power architecture. So as mentioned before, in the past there were power PCs, power architecture was somehow a little stronger before. Power architecture is getting market share or gaining market share in the last couple of years, but the overall Unix market is decreasing that fast that it's basically not really working out well for keeping that architecture just how it is. So you need to find other means to strengthen the whole infrastructure and the architecture over those boundaries and see how you can work with other parties to get into other different markets. And that was basically the root cause to basically get this Open Power Initiative being done in 2013. If you look at the upper part of this chart, it back then it looked like all those companies somehow losing market share overall tried to come together and found something. But basically looking at it these days, it somehow looks like a good move. And let me show you how that worked out. The first steps that were done were basically done by IBM. First of all, basically investing a lot of money into Linux, Linux being able to run on power. That was a complaint even done by engineers internally over the last decades, basically, that even our own applications were not running really good on our own machines because our own compute pool was mainly based on x86 machines because we were selling them also before. So that was a strong complaint, but it didn't help to complain internally. But the customers basically showed us that with power machines, we were not really able to beat the market. So there was some kind of mind shift going on and basically resulted in investing a lot of money in restructuring the code around Linux and basically even little endian, big endian complications to sort them out and get them resolved at the end. Second thing is this kind of open source model for hardware. I think I will talk about that in a minute. And basically, the third step to release lots of firmware code to really make it available. I myself was even surprised. Sometimes I just Googled my name and some kind of word. Surprisingly, one of the first five matches was just some C file that I wrote myself with a colleague. So just try to search for it. You should find it rather easily on the net now. This is the mission statement. I think nothing to really read through completely, but the idea behind this is it's not a new company to found, but it's some kind of partnership or some open community that basically is to be installed to get people together that want to improve the power architecture as well as to work on the whole stack. So that includes basically the basics of the hardware development as well as the software development flow and basically use same tooling, use same infrastructure, use same boundaries. That's just a picture to illustrate that on the left. So you have the hardware component. That basically consists basically of, first of all, the processor itself. And still, the processor doesn't help much. You need to have some connection points, and which is basically interfaces to accelerators. And not just those interfaces, but have them rather open that other companies can also reuse them. And also roadmaps for both of it. That's what I learned also very early in my work, that customers really want to see a roadmap over the next couple of years that they are very can be sure to invest in your product and can be sure that this continues over the next technology cycles. As well as the software stack above of it to make sure that this is basically common and being used by many different parties and that it basically gets debugged well. And that basically gets us to the ecosystem as of today. So the chart before that I showed, you have seen there were 5 parties founding this community, and now you have basically a whole stack that is basically starting with the basics at the bottom, now with Infinium IBM as well included with the chips. Then you have board manufacturers, I/O storage companies, system integration companies, also software. But as well, you have many research teams included. And that's basically something that is also a key interest of that group, to not just do something with companies and try to sell stuff, but also to keep people involved in research and trying to get this whole method enhanced. To just sum up, like 220 members as of today in 32 countries. These days, I think most of that is still centered around the US, because there is basically the headquarters of IBM and the main labs still located, and that's why also many of the universities there joined in those areas. But still, basically, try to get members over the whole stack, and even those partners also started to bring out first products. But I think I have one chart for that later as well. That's basically just to illustrate also how Open Power somehow matches all the other initiatives. So we have this Open Compute Group that is, I think, more concentrating on mechanical, electrical synchronization and specifications. The Open Power Group somehow is trying to fill that gap between whatever is coming from top, from software, Linux, OpenStack, and Open Compute at the bottom. OpenCAPI is somehow part of that Open Power initiative, but it's basically just one factor of it. And basically, as you can see, this green box in there basically limits itself to protocols and I/O interconnections internally. So that's how it should fit, or how it's intended to be. And now, what's so special about it? Just to show you, that's the current roadmap. Not sure if this is even still accurate, but at least it gives you an overview how that was being worked out over the last years. So as a processor manufacturer, you try to have a real good sense of regular push of products out into the market. So there are different needs. If you look at power, there are different circumstances because you have a different market that you want to attack. If you look at C architecture, this will look much different. A C processor will come out each and every time at the same point in time. So there is a very regular pattern. While on the power side, there needs to be much more flexibility due to the customer changes or market changes at the end. But as you can see, in the next years, 10, 7 nanometers are the products that need to come out and basically will be specified and pushed with the partners. But that's the really interesting thing about the Open Power Initiative, that you somehow try to connect at the end, as I mentioned before, external accelerators into the system. It's not just to plug them into, but to make them part of the system, to make them part of the address map of the processor. So it's not just an I/O link, some PCI or so, but it's a protocol layer that makes it really fast compared to other customers. Also, with this Power 8 enhanced product built together with NVIDIA, the NV link was introduced as an its own link built into the CPU to make that bandwidth much faster into those GPUs. Not sure if you heard about this announcement quite some weeks ago, where those labs in the US were basically distributed with those new systems. There was some kind of government contract won by NVIDIA together with IBM to distribute those systems, and basically they consist with the latest hardware of power processors connected to the latest GPUs, and basically built a room full of those servers and basically make possible some better computations. And basically that uses the newest generation of the NVLink, and basically that provides bandwidth that you are not able to get with other CPUs. That's the same thing, but you see that you have those interfaces not just over NVLink, you still have PCI generations available to get that faster just with the CAPI extensions that you have. And here you can get Xilinx products attached also with CAPI, OpenCAPI, which is basically this new protocol and hardware built into the processor. This is just for numbers, not for marketing. Basically, they were able, Forbes were able, ExxonMobil was able to basically reduce 23,000 servers into 30 open power servers, just to get an idea what that makes at the end. Just for the numbers, that's regarding the community itself. The idea is basically to get or to have the possibility to get everybody involved. That means people that write software, people that use software, or people at the end that use the whole systems, and try to basically get those different interest groups together and have a place for them in that overall community. And that's why they created different work groups to get more into technical discussions and basically technical solutions at the end. And that's basically what we currently have today. There are different 13 different work groups available. There are some that I'm even involved with some colleagues. And that's basically talking about real problems and solutions at the end, basically trying to solve them at different points of the stack. And that's basically should be the last slide regarding what that is at the end. It's still something that costs money. That's why companies need to spend money to be part of open power. But if you are coming from academia, then you are able to spend $0 and still be part of the community. And there's different levels between them. It needs to be somehow a little bureaucratic that way, obviously, but you are able to get involved, especially if you are coming from research. I have even checked today, TU München should be involved, the Paderborn University I have seen on the chart as well today. So there are already some German universities joining that community, but most of them were still located in the US. So that was all from my side, just a brief overview. So it was not intended to be in depth, also not complete. If you have more questions, just come to me, and I give you also contacts to other people if you want to talk more details regarding any interfaces or any contacts into those work groups. But at first, you should check openpower.org. That's the website where you can get more information about that. And I hope that gave you some inspiration and some information about what is going on in the hardware community.
Thank you very much, Matteo. We do have time for a few questions, and someone already lined up. Mic one, please.
Hi, thanks for your talk. As a hacker, how can I get a open power development board if I'm not like a big data center like Google or someone?
I think if you have contacts to universities, it should be possible to get something there. Yeah, that would be my advice.
I'm not a university.
No. So, but I'm sure if you are an hacking activist, you should have contacts in that group. But I think you can even maybe get some older stuff, since you've seen there are the oldest boards were coming with P8. P8 is already the older version now, previous version. So Power 9 is now rolled out. So maybe there are also some possibilities to get some older machines available.
The internet woke up and has a question.
Yes, so you talked about companies and academia joining OpenPower, and one user wants to know, are there plans from IBM's side to offer affordable systems to consumers so they can join?
I think that's at the end, it's at least an idea for companies to get cheap systems available for the real end user. I think it's not the current target, since it's also not the market IBM is looking into. So it's more a business-related issue at the moment.
Mike Four.
Hello. One question about the firmware. You said it's 400,000 lines of code. Why is it that big, and why couldn't you just reuse Coreboot, which already supports OpenPower, the older generations?
That would be a specific question. I think it's just the stack that is coming out with the machines already, at least from an IBM side. And I think the same is coming from Google. They have additional lines of code written for their stuff, and basically they just released what they already have. So it would be a question to the firmware development teams why they don't do reuse as you suspected.
Mike Two.
A question regarding Moore's Law. It's never been about performance. It's been about number of transistors. So do you have some numbers for OpenPower regarding that?
I don't have numbers here. Need to look that up somewhere, I guess. But basically, at the end, performance is that what counts for the customers. So they look at performance, and that performance is that what you can sell. And Moore's Law was the thing to improve performance over time. And now it's not that easy anymore. That's why you need to find just other means.
Unfortunately, there are quite a few questions lining up. Unfortunately, we are out of time. I'm very sorry for that. But I think, Matteo, you're still around. So grab him and ask him in person. So please give another round of applause for Matteo. Thank you very much.